of Jesus Christ. Very quickly, we'll be looking at God's intent for the woman. God's intent for the woman. The team says, I am God's idea. I am God's idea means it was God who decided to create me. I am as a result of God's decision. Amen. So, the topic we are looking at was drawn from the theme, God's intent. When we talk about God's intent, we are talking about the purpose of God for the woman. Why were you created? Why? Why were you created? What is God's intent? What did God see that made him to create the woman? Why was he not satisfied after creating every other thing? And he said, there is this one thing that is remaining. That's what we'll be looking at today. Amen. Praise the Lord. I don't intend to keep us for too long. Very brief talk and then we are done. But I want to assure you that somebody, your life will be transformed in the name of Jesus Christ. A lot has been said about the woman. It has been said a lot has been said. It has been said that the woman is inferior. It has been said that the woman is a second-class citizen. It has been said that it's a man's world. It has gotten to a point where people see the woman as, some men see the woman as commodity. That's when you hear some men saying, this is my first wife, my second wife, my third wife. They're counting in number one, number two, as if they're counting cars. My first car, my second car, my third car. And so somehow, the notion or the perspective of the world has filtered into our minds as women. Consciously or unconsciously, some of us have accepted the notion that the world has given to us. But the truth is, by the grace of God, today God will open your eyes to see his intent for you, why you were created, so that you have a better understanding of who you are and not what the world is saying about you. I hope you can hear me clearly. Praise God. Colossians chapter 1. Verse 16, Father, bless your word this morning. Let it make impact, let it transform our lives and make us better persons in you in the name of Jesus Christ. Colossians chapter 1 verse 16, it says, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities, all powers, all things were created by him and for him. By him and for him. I take it again. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. For him. Revelation 4 verse 11. You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and power and honor, for you have created all things, and for your pleasure they are and were created. For your pleasure they are, which means for your pleasure they exist. For your pleasure they were created. So the number one reason God created the woman is to please himself. I'm going to give you just three and we'll shut down. The number one reason God created the woman is for his pleasure. Your purpose on earth, there are other reasons we know, but the primary reason why you are on earth is that your life pleases God. He created all things for his pleasure. All things that were created by him and for him. Don't let anybody deceive you. The number one reason you were created is for you to have a personal fellowship and relationship with God. God wants to enjoy a communion with you. He wants to have fellowship with you. He wants to bond with you. He wants to have pleasure with you. But the problem is, most of us don't know. And because we don't know, we are not harnessing that purpose. God created you for himself first, before any other thing. But there's a problem. Most of us have become too busy to have time for God. As women, you are thinking of husband, thinking of children, thinking of business, thinking of so many things on your head. And then you now leave God behind or at the bottom of your list of priorities. Some of us, even in the morning, you wake up in the morning, you don't even have time to do devotion. Few minutes to spend time with God to pray. We don't have the time. You wake up in the morning, you are rushing. Your shop, your customer, your office, school run. That few minutes for prayers and worship to fellowship with God daily. Most of us, we cannot do it because we have become too busy. And then the primary reason you were created is being defeated without you knowing. Every root is connected. Every tree is connected to its root. And every resource is connected. Every source is connected to every resource is connected to its source. And that is how every creature is supposed to be connected to his creator. So if you were created by God and you are not connected to God, you become a misfit. If a tree can stay connected to its roots, a resource is connected to its source. Now, if you see it, you can tell there's a connection. This is where it came from. That's how you are supposed to stay connected to your creator daily. It should be a lifestyle. If God created you and then there's a disconnection between you and God, maybe because you have become too busy or for some reason or the other, you don't have a personal relationship with God, is a colossal error. It is a waste of an entire lifetime for you to exist without God. And it is very dangerous and risky. What it means is that the aim of your being created is being defeated. And we are doing these things because God is merciful. Everything is just happening. Your business is still moving. Things are going. And you think that God is happy. He's just watching you. The Bible says that God repented for making Saul a king. God repented. What does that mean? To repent of something means to review the decision. To review the action. And it can be as a result of regret. And that can only happen when the thing is not fulfilling the purpose of it. So even God too can regret sometimes. He said he repented for creating Saul. So God is watching you. What it simply means is that when you are not fulfilling the purpose for which you were created, God can repent for creating you. So God might be looking at you and say, I created this woman for me to have communion, fellowship, bond, pleasure with her. But she has forgotten me. She's now busy with her personal interests. I'm no longer important. May God not repent for creating you. How busy can you be? There are some women in the Bible that I love so much, and I always like to talk about them. They were so busy, yet they stayed connected to God and their walk with God. The first set of women is, the first person I would like to talk about is Lydia. The Bible tells us about Lydia in the ministry of Paul. You cannot be more busy than Lydia. She was an international businesswoman, importing and exporting. That was her business. And yet she was so dedicated and committed in the things of God. She served under the ministry of Paul. She was one of the first converts that Paul had in a city that he went for missions. And she gave herself to kingdom works, even gave her life, her house for church. That the disciples at some point, apostles, were not living in her house. They were using her house for church. She was preaching the gospel, doing evangelism, doing sanctuary, doing ushering, and yet she still prospered in business. And then some of us, just one small shop like this, they will never see you in evening service, only Sunday. One small shop, compare your own, compare Lydia's own. One small shop like this, evening service time, 5 o'clock, that's when your customers are coming more. And your mind has not told you that this could be a deception. It could be a trick of the devil. Why is it now? You cannot shut down your business to be in church. And yet, God who created you said, forsake not the gathering of my people. You cannot shut down your business. These days, we hear all sorts of things. Popcorn. The popcorn that I made, the one that was remaining in the show glass, has not finished. I just wanted it to finish before I would come. Popcorn made you not to come to church. Excuse me? This is the salvation that Jesus died for. This thing you are playing with is what somebody paid for with his blood. And then popcorn. How much do you want to make between that 5 o'clock and 7 o'clock? That your church is serving God. You're having a session in the presence of God. Between that 5 and that 7, is that when you make all the money that you don't make for the whole day? No, some of us are laughing. It's not a joke. Because if you are God, put yourself in the shoes of God. And you are seeing these things. People you created that should have time for you, that should take your work serious. This is what Jesus died for. This is what he paid for with his blood. And then we are playing with it. Look at Deborah. Deborah was a wife, a mother, a judge, and a prophetess. You can't be more busy than Deborah. Only being a judge alone is enough to make her busy, more busy than anything. A woman, one woman, judging an entire nation. That office is even more busy than the office of our president. God, president, when people have cases, they go to court. But this one, she's is at our office. Every day she comes out to sit in that office. And you trust woman, anywhere there's woman, there's problem. So daily, there's queue. She's settling cases. Yes, she's a wife. She's a mother. She's a prophetess. She also did not fail in her work with God. She still served God fervently. And she was committed in the things. So how busy can you be that God has become secondary in your life? How busy? How busy? And it is he, God, that blesses the works of your hands. Look at Lydia. The Bible says she prospered in business. She prospered in business. When you have time for God, God will have time for you. When you give attention to his work, he will give attention to your business. For by strength shall no man prevail. If you focus too much on that, your business, and then you put God behind, God will also put you behind. You will struggle. You will struggle. Even if you think you're making little profit, you will struggle to make the little profit. You will not be fulfilled. You will not. Look at these women that serve the Lord in the Bible with their hearts, with all they have. God made them relevant. Lydia prospered in business. Deborah, a judge, a prophetess, a mother, and a wife. And yet she succeeded in all of that. Another woman is Anna. 80-something years old woman. 80-something. She was still committed in the church. She was practically living in the church. These are lovers of God that we're supposed to learn from. Not what we see these days, club. No? It's not club that God saw and he created you, no. It is church that he saw. It's church, it's not club. Some of us are so committed with all of these societies outside the church, but in church, you are the ones that come late. It's an upside down arrangement. It's a paradox. But that is not what God saw when he created you. He created you so that you will be his lover. Let her be a lover of God. That's what Lydia was, Deborah was, Anna was. And like I told you, if you have time for God, He will have time for you. Everybody that served God passionately, God made them relevant. Look at Anna. You can hardly preach the gospel without somehow connecting it to Hannah, because she was one of the first people that saw Jesus when he was born. She was one of the first persons that saw the Messiah. Why? She was committed to the things of God. She was still doing evangelism at 80 something. She was still interceding. She was still praying towards the coming of the Lord Jesus. Be a lover of God. And then we'll go to the ministry of Jesus. In the ministry of Jesus, we also saw some women. I don't know how many, but the Bible says Mary Magdalene was there, Joanna was there, Susanna was there, and the Bible says many others. Many other women. They were committed to the ministry of Jesus Christ. They were disciples. Jesus had women as disciples, though, in case you don't know it. He had women in his ministry as disciples. It's only 12 that the Bible registered. The men, 12 men that worked closely with him in the field. But there were other people that were his disciples, and there were, the Bible says, many women. These women, what did they do? They served the Lord. They served God with their time, not only with their time, their talents, not only with their talents, with their money. The Bible was very specific about that. In Luke chapter 8, verse 2 to 3. You will see them there. Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Susanna, the Bible says, and many other women. They worked with Jesus. They served with Jesus. And they supported his work with their money. Money. Anybody that tells you that the gospel or church does not need money, the person is being unreasonable. This is Jesus' ministry. Jesus is our standard. Am I right? This is Jesus' ministry. Luke chapter 8, verse 2 to 3, you will see there. The Bible says that they supported Jesus' work with their money, their personal money. Mary Magdalene's own, the Bible says that she traveled with Jesus and his disciples from place to place, providing their needs. They need food, she will buy. Slippers, they will buy. That was her calling. That was her own. She just focused on that one. She was committed to it. As they were going, she was going with them, traveling with them from place to place, providing their needs. The Bible was specific. These are lovers of God, who fulfilled the primary reason why they were created. Leave the other ones first. Let's finish this one. Because many of us are failing in this one, but we don't know. What are you doing for God as a woman that you'll be remembered for? These women, we are remembering them. We are talking about them. We are making reference to them. What will you be remembered for? You can take it as a personal commitment to take care of your pastor. Take it as a personal commitment or your pastor's wife. Many years ago, there was a woman that came to me. She said, God told her to be taking care of my clothes, my shoes. Yeah, I think just clothes and shoes. She didn't have a child. She has been barren for many years. So she said, God told her. She told me, I prayed for her. And she started doing it. She would just go, she would buy clothes. Sometimes she would bring shoes. Sometimes she was committed. She knew what she had. God didn't tell me to tell her. God told her. And she engaged her need to the act. As she was doing it, God opened her womb. Now she has two children. She has two, a boy and a girl. See, God is not a robber. Whatever you give to him, he multiplies back to you. So whatever you are doing in the house of God is for your own good. My husband always says you cannot improve God. God is already an improved God. Whatever you do for him is to improve your own self. Now let me show you something. I told you that when you serve God wholeheartedly, it makes you relevant. Look at the women that sponsored the ministry of Jesus with their money. Let me tell you how relevant God made them to be. When Jesus died, Jesus did not forget. God does not forget. When he died and resurrected, guess what? These people that supported his ministry with their finance, they were the first people he appeared to. When he resurrected, he went to show himself to them. They were the first set. And he told them, I have resurrected. Go and tell the men. Go and tell. The men were there. Jesus would have gone to them. But he chose to go to the women that supported his work with money. I know why I'm emphasizing on it, but I'm being specific. Because so much has been said. Social media is deceiving people. But I'm showing you Jesus' ministry now. And he said to them, he said, go and tell the men that I have resurrected. So you see this gospel that we are preaching, gospel of salvation. Jesus has risen. Come to him. Receive him as your Lord and Savior. These women were the first people that preached it. They were the first because when Jesus resurrected, they were the ones that saw him. He appeared to them. He told them, I have risen. Go and tell the world that I have risen. Go and tell the disciples I have risen. And then they went to the apostles. By so doing, Jesus made them apostles to the apostles. Which other relevance is bigger than that one? Which other relevance? They became apostles to the apostles. Why? They reaped what they sowed in the ministry of Jesus. Jesus did not forget. God does not forget. Whatever you do for him, he doesn't forget. It is waiting for you in front. He will multiply back in another way. Hallelujah. So that's number one. God created you for his pleasure. Derive joy in the things of God. Derive joy in serving God. In that your church, ask yourself, what can I be doing consistently? Don't be the one that is only coming to church to be blessed. Others will clean chair for you. Others will sweep church for you. Others will sing and bless. Which one are you doing? Which one? Fix yourself somewhere. No matter how busy you are, there must be somewhere you can fit in. This is your father's work. Your father's work. Praise God. So the second reason, intent of God for the woman, Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. This is the one that most of us love, or the most common, the most popular, that has also been misinterpreted a lot. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. I'm reading Amplified Version. The Bible says, now the Lord God said, it is not good that a man should be alone. I will make him a helper, meet for him. Amplified Version. Now the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper, meet for him. Now, there's something I want you to discover from this verse. One hidden truth there that I want you to get. And that hidden truth is, have you realized from this verse that it was not the man that asked for the woman? Are you with me? It was not the man that said, I cannot say this word alone, no. God, I need another person to join me. It was not the man. It was not the man that requested for the woman. It was God that saw the need for the woman. That's why when I tell you are God's idea, it's scriptural. It was God that saw the need. He saw a vacuum in the life of the man. And he said, no, I need to create something to fill up this vacuum. It was his idea. It was his decision. Solely his opinion. The man was not involved. The man didn't even know that anything like that was possible. He was just focused on the work that God gave to him. Tend the garden, dress it and keep it. That was what he was focused on. But God saw loneliness. God saw that he needed somebody. He needed a companion. And then he decided to create the woman. So that's the first thing I want you to get. It was God's decision. It was not the man that asked for the woman.
Now, there's another thing I want you to understand. Because you see this companion and helper thing, many people have misinterpreted it. Even you too, sometimes you don't like to hear it. God created you to be a helper to the man. You don't like to hear it. How can I just be created just to be helper? Helper. But you don't know that there's glory in it. I will show you the glory. There is glory in it. That even if, even the men, when they know the glory, they wish to be you. I will show you. There's a glory in being a companion and a helper. When I show you, after today, you will loud it. You will be proud of it. You will shout it. I am a companion and a helper to the man. Because there is glory in it. And what is that glory? Have you discovered that in the Bible, there are only two persons that the Bible used helper, the word helper, to refer to? There are only two persons. Number one, the Holy Spirit. Number two, the woman. So you are to your husband what the Holy Spirit is to the believer. Now, the word helper, is it still sounding like slave? Is this still sounding like outside? You are to your husband what the Holy Spirit is to the believer. The difference is the relationship order. That's the difference. That's the only difference. The Holy Spirit is to help the man while leading the man. But you are to help the man while he leads you. That's the difference. But he's helper, you are helper. Helper is helper. Hallelujah. Let's see John. John chapter 15, verse 26. John 16, verse 26, Amplified Version. Talking about the Holy Spirit. The Bible says, but when the Comforter, Counselor, Helper, Advocate, Intercessor, Strengthener, Standby comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of Truth, whom comes, proceeds from the Father, he himself will testify regarding me. There's something I want you to get here. The first part of it, it says, but when the Comforter, Counselor, Helper, Advocate, Intercessor, Strengthener, Standby. Who is a standby? Anybody that always stands by you is what? A companion. So the Holy Spirit is a companion and a helper to the believer. You are a companion and a helper to your husband. Holy Spirit is a companion to the believer. You are a companion to your husband. Holy Spirit is a helper to the believer. You are a helper to your husband. So there is glory in being a companion and a helper. You have to celebrate it. And like I said, the only difference is the relationship order. And that's where most of us are making mistakes. Because naturally you are meant to help. You are created to help. God deposited in you what it takes, the ability to help. It's always there. It's there embedded in you. So you tend to want to lead your husband while helping him. That's where most of us make the mistake, because it is easier to lead and help than to be led and help. For instance, I am to lead an adult to somewhere and to lead a child to some, sorry, I am to help an adult and I am to help a child. Which one will be easier? I am to help a child. I am to help an adult. Which one is easier? It's easier to help a child than an adult, because an adult also has leadership wisdom in him. So we argue with you. Who told you that this is the right one? Let's try this one first. So it will be difficult, but a child does not know anyone. You are just leading the child and he's following you with so much of trust. It's easier that way. You know the right path. So you just lead the child. But an adult will never believe that you know the right path. He will want to negotiate. So it is easier to lead and help. That's why most of us make the mistake. Because naturally you are meant to help. You find yourself trying to lead and help. You are not meant to lead and help. You are meant to help and be led. So allow the man be the head that God has made him to be. And helping him, just help him in being the help, the head. Help him to achieve the purpose of God for his life. Your being a helper is not washing clothes, cooking food. It's beyond washing clothes and cooking food. Fine, it may be part of it. These days now, there's a new campaign. There's a pastor, a very popular pastor. If I call his name, some of us will know him. The man is saying that it was the man that God gave work. He only brought the woman to help, and to help means to assist. Which means even the work in the house, the washing of clothes and the cookies for the man, the woman is meant to help. Praise God. Amen. There are different dimensions, but that's not where I'm going to. That's not my business. Praise the Lord. But what I'm trying to tell you is this. Your helping, the ability that God gave to you, is too heavy for you to limit, for you to be limited to helping in domestic chores. Some of you just think helping is just you wash his clothes, you cook his food, you serve him, satisfy him sexually. Your help is beyond that. You are meant to help the man fulfill his purpose. You are meant to help him achieve his dreams and aspirations. It takes a womb to birth anything. Am I right? It takes a womb to birth a child. It also takes a womb to birth visions. You are the one that has the womb. A man does not have a womb. You are a man with a womb. Womb man. That's where the name came from. Womb man. The bee is silent. Womb man. Womb man. You carry the womb. The man does not have. You have what it takes to birth. To give birth. To deliver. So when the man conceives a vision in his heart, your responsibility is to birth the vision. Support him. Make it possible for him to achieve it. Whatever he has seen, it is your responsibility to make sure that he achieves it. He wakes up one morning, he tells you, I have a dream. I have a vision. I want to own this. I want to be this. I want to be that. See, forget them. They can talk. But really, what it takes to achieve it, you are the one that has it. That's why God placed you in his life. And somebody might say that there are some men that are not married and they are still doing it. They may do well, but they will struggle to do well. It will be easier if there is a woman in their life. That's what the Bible says. He that findeth a way, find a good thing and obtains favor. When they obtain favor, they will do far better than they will ever do without a woman. God has given you what it takes to bet every vision, to bet every dream. There is a woman in the Bible that whenever we talk about her, we talk about her in a negative light. But there is a positive side of that woman. And that woman is Jezebel. There is a positive side of Jezebel. We don't like to talk about her. When they want to talk about that, we talk about the negative. She was wicked. She killed people. She did that. She served Baal. There is a positive side of Jezebel. And what's that positive side? Jezebel knew her place in the life of her husband. She knew who she was in the life of her husband. She knew what she was meant to do in the life of her husband. She knew what she was meant to do. She knew her place. She knew her purpose. The only problem is that she did not have a foundation in God. That's why she did the right things the wrong way. She did the right things the wrong way. And it destroyed her. That's why if you're not careful, if you don't learn to do the right things the right way, if you get it wrong, you can destroy that man. And destroy yourself. But talking about knowing, she knew her place. Walked into the room, saw the man looking sad. Whether sleeping or lying or sitting, I can't remember. But shy, he was looking sad. The food they gave him, he did not He did not eat it, it was there. And then she was wondering, she said, this cannot be my husband. Not when I'm alive. What is the problem? He said, there's one farm somewhere there that I want to buy. The owner said he will not sell. And Jezebel said, is that all? Leave it to me. Is that all? Give me 1 hour. Is that all? Just give me 1 week. Is that all? That's why your face is like this. Just this thing that you just said now. Go to sleep. You don't have a problem. That's why God put you in the life of that man. Sometimes they just have a lot in their head, but they don't know how to go about it. They don't know. You are the one that knows. That's why wisdom is a woman. You don't know that wisdom is a woman. It's in the Bible now. Bible calls wisdom she. Go and read your Bible. She. And Bible also says a wise woman built was her house. And Bible also says that with wisdom shall a house be built. So who is the wisdom? You see, these men, they may have the physical energy, ability, and everything, but what it takes, it is you that have it. That's why God put you in their life. Imagine a world without woman, it will be upside down. Upside. Amen. Have you ever tested those of you that are married? Have you ever tested your husband, leave the children at home? Only one day. Leave the children at home with him. Just go out. It takes wisdom to manage children. And you see them, before you even reach the end of your street, they have called you. Please, you need to come. Amen. You have the wisdom to achieve anything that you want to achieve. And one unique virtue that God gave to the woman. God knew that the woman has a lot to play. A major role to play. In her life, in her husband's and in her world. And he gave her one thing. One beautiful thing, silent but powerful thing. With which she can conquer her world. With which she can achieve anything. And what is that thing? Influence. Every woman, whether you know it or you don't know it, you have the power of influence. It's inside you. It's there. It's there. You may not know it. It's probably not working for you because you don't know you have it. You have it. So long as you have a womb, you also, it's like a default. It comes simultaneously. Influence comes with womb. So long as you have a womb, you have the power of influence. Some of you struggle. You stress yourself too much. Authority. You want to struggle with a man. God gave them authority, gave you influence. And influence is more powerful than authority. He's more powerful. For instance, a man can come and shout, sit down there. I said, sit down there. The child will sit because he shouted. Not because she's convinced to sit. As the man leaves, she will get up. But a woman influences the child. What is influence? Ability to convince. So now when you convince the child to sit, the child now starts seeing the reason to sit. Whether you are there or you are not there, the child will be seated. So you are stressing yourself, trying to use authority. The man talk one, you talk two. Hey, she said this, you said that. Ha, you are shouting, you are doing this. I say it must be like this. It must not be like this. He quotes scripture, you quote your own. Have you not seen lawyers when they are quarreling, husband and wife? I have one lawyer. Yeah. Maybe you will give us the constitution that they're using. Constitution this subsection, this says, the other one will say, hey, this constitution sub this sub also says, you are stressing yourself for nothing. One button you will press like this, problem is solved. But you don't know the button to press. Influence is in you, is inside you, is natural, is there. You don't struggle.
struggle with a man authority. God created them with it naturally. He gave it to them for the purpose of leadership, because they are meant to lead. He gave it to them. So if you are trying to show power, it's like you are using knife to fight a man with cutlass. Your husband talk when you talk to. It's like you carry knife, you want to fight man that has cutlass. You cannot match it. There is one that God gave you that is very silent, but is more powerful. All you need to do is to know how to use it. The Bible says, present your strong reason. You see this thing called submissiveness, eh? Many of us don't like to hear it, but it is for your own good. You don't like to hear it, but it's for your own good. Submissiveness is for your own good. God knows that it will favor you. That's why it says submit. Men physically look hard. But when you see a godly man or not demon-possessed man, when you see a man that is godly, that has a wife that honors him, that submits to him, that respects him, you see that man, he will melt over you like ice cream. Have people not heard when people say, it's his wife that's controlling him? It's his wife that's controlling him. Woman rapper. But there's a funny thing that I want people to also realize. Despite any couple that you see that is happy, the woman is respectful, submissive, honors the man, you know, cares for him, does everything. And people are talking. Naturally, it's like that. God arranged it like that. When a godly man has that kind of wife, he's ready to give her anything. Give her the world. There's something that you have not realized. All those men that people say, woman rapper, have you discovered that they don't care? They don't say no. They like it. They are in it. Why? Leave the people that are outside that are not inside. You that is inside, you know that the woman is not controlling you. But you gave her your all, because she's fulfilling the right purpose that she's supposed to fulfill in your life. She's submissive. She's honoring you. She loves you. That is how men are meant to be by nature. It's only when you want to show yourself authority. That's when they will not prove to you that they don't want to have it naturally. But when you submit, have you asked yourself why Esther? The king told Esther, I will give you anything, even up to half of my kingdom. Have you asked yourself? Oh no. The same king that dethroned a woman, Vashti, you dethroned one yesterday. Today you are telling one, I'll give you up to half of my kingdom. And two of them committed the same offense. You don't know they committed the same offense. Eh? Should I tell you? You don't know. One did not come when she was supposed to come. One came when she was not supposed to come. You don't know. And by law, you come when you're not supposed to come. At that time, you are meant to be killed. But instead, the man said, ask me anything. I will give you even up to half of my... Are you seeing that if you are not submissive and respectful to your husband, you are missing? You are the one that is missing. You are depriving yourself of the love of the man. Because life is scratch my back, I scratch your back. Honor me and respect you, I will give you everything. That is all they need. No man is difficult. Know how to press the right button. He will respond. That's all. So talking about influence, what does it take to influence your husband? Learn to honor him. Learn to respect him. Learn to care for him. Love him. As a godly woman is supposed to do. When you do all of this, he will naturally love you. And when you love something, you always want to please the thing that you love. Am I right? So now, coming to influencing him, the power of influence is not meant to be abused. You are not meant to use it wrongly for your own selfish reasons. Just like Eve was another woman that would have been the best wife ever. She had the power of influence, but the problem is that she used it wrongly.
She used it to destroy the man instead of using it to fulfill the man. Now, when you are submissive, that's your first weapon, your first key to open the heart of the man. You are respectful. You honor him. You love him. You give him what he wants. And then you, with that you have, is a currency. With that you buy the love. Now, when he wants to do something, and you have sensed it, you have perceived that that is not the right thing to do, it will not lead him to a fulfillment. But he's not seeing it. You are the one that is seeing it. What you do, you apply the power of influence. The Bible says, present your strong reasons. Somebody that loves you will listen to you. When he listens to you, you talk to him. Every woman has the ability to convince anybody because of the power of influence that they have. So when you talk to him and you present your strong reason and he sees it, he will make the decision by himself according to how you want it. That's influence. It's not control. Is that not control? It's not control. You see people saying he's controlling him, he's controlling. It's not control. It's influence. Because finally, he's not the one that decided. What you did was to show him why it is better to do it that way. So when your husband comes and says, I have a dream, as a woman, you must vow to yourself, this is what my husband wants to do. This is what he wants to become. I will go any length to make sure that he achieves it, because that is why you are in his life in the first place. Do all it takes. If your husband is a pastor, be the first to be in church. He's a businessman. Know the business. Understand it. Pay attention to it. Give your best to it to make sure it works. That's what Jezebel did. The only problem is that she did it the wrong way. Don't be the one killing his vision. We have seen some pastors' wives that will tell you that there's a popular one. I don't want to use the name. But let me just say, Francis. You say, now Francis, now go call. No, be me. People will go to her for prayer. Mommy, pray for me. You say, now Francis, now go call. Now Francis, now go call. Go and meet Francis. You're killing the man's vision. You're killing his purpose. You have to be a frontliner in your husband's, whatever he's doing, in his agenda, in his business. You have to be a push, a strong force in it. Because that is the reason you were created. The worst thing that can happen to anybody is for the person to pass through this world without fulfilling the purpose for which he was created. Then it's better you didn't come to the world at all. Yeah, it's better. It is better. Pay attention to whatever your husband. Don't be I don't care kind of wife. I don't care. Even if it's an engineer, you didn't study engineering, at least have idea of engineering. So that the day he is in a fix, he has a challenge, difficult, he doesn't know what to do, and he shares it with you, you will have something to tell him. You will have an idea to give to him. Had it been Jezebel had a foundation in God, God would have led her into using the right approaches. She would have still achieved the same things she wanted to achieve using the right approach. That is why I started by telling you, stay close to God. Because you see, this is your assignment in this world. It is the wisdom of God that you need to achieve it. It is the direction of God. Ideas come from God. So when your husband is at a fix, he doesn't know what to do, and then you pray about it, before you know, an idea will drop. And once it drops, you share, have you tried this thing? And then he tries it, and then there's a solution. That man will respect you for life. He's controlling why husband is controlling. It's not control. She is a solution provider to the man. That's why the man honors her. So be a solution provider to your husband. That is what it means to be a helper. When there's problem, provide solution. Hallelujah. Another important factor I would like to share with us is that as a woman, your prayer life should be burning. Your prayer life, it should be on fire. If you are a woman, you are not praying, you are at risk. You are exposed. You are at risk. Because to be able to convince a man, you need to be able to pray and be led by the Holy Spirit. Like I said, ideas come from God. Be close to God. You can't fulfill your mission, your assignment, without being close to Him. He will lead you into how to go about everything. And there are so much challenges in the life of a woman. You need prayers. If you're not praying, you're at risk. You're at risk. There are so many girls out there, their eyes are red. That need that your husband. I'm not joking, no. I'm preaching. I'm telling you the truth. There's a case I handled recently. This marriage was at the verge of breaking up. The man has already started talking about divorce. The man has already started saying, I don't even know how I ended up in this marriage. Something like that. I don't even know how I married you. Something like that. I am not quoting him as that, but that's the point. He has started regretting the marriage already. And then I called the lady. I said, you have tried everything. This problem is not solving. And the man is still angry. The man is still talking about being tired of the marriage and all. Have you tried prayers? Have you prayed? You have tried this. You know what? You have tried that. Have you prayed? So coincidentally, we're starting 7 days prayers in church, a program, prayer program, set for 7 days. That was the first day. That was counseling the woman. Was the first day. So I told her, I said, we're having 7 days prayers in church. Be a part of it. Take opportunity, engage yourself in these prayers. And let this thing be your number one prayer point. And let's see how it goes. Because by experience, I can tell you that prayer works. It works like fire. And she took my advice. In fact, the case was so serious that it's not only the woman that reported it to me, some other persons also called me about the matter to tell me that something like this is going on in this marriage or blah, blah, blah. So it was that serious. So I told her, I said, take this thing, this prayer serious for 7 days. And she took it serious. Guess what? The last day of the prayer was when her testimony dropped. The last day of the prayer. I can't give you details, but the last day of the prayer was when God stepped in. And everything turned like this. In less than 1 month, the man that said he was tired of marriage bought her a car. In less than a month. The same man that was complaining. See, there is nothing prayer cannot do. If you are a woman, you are not praying. You are missing. You see that your marriage, put it on the altar of prayer. Because there are so many out there that are not happy that you are happy. There are so many. So many that want to take your place. So many. But it won't work. Time will not permit me to talk about marriage so much. Because marriage is a curriculum on its own. Amen? Marriage is an entire curriculum on its own. But I'll take this opportunity to invite us. We are having our women convention in church in Asaba. It's this week. This starting on Friday. I'm going to be talking a little bit on certain things I've spoken here. But it's going to be on a broader platform. I'm going to expand it more. I'm going to be dealing on marriage. So I'm inviting you, if you can make it, come around Friday, Saturday, and Sunday is our women's convention. But let me just give you the principle of marriage. I cannot say so much about it, but let me just give you how I personally summarized it. Marriage, the Bible says, woman submit, man love. Am I right? And the same scripture, the same chapter also says, submit yourself one unto another. Am I right? Yes. Which means submissiveness is both ways. It's not only from the woman. And you cannot submit to what you don't love as a woman. And as a man, you cannot love something without submitting to it. Whatever you love, naturally you will submit. You will, so far you love any, so far you love something, you will want to please the thing. So that is why God balanced it by saying, submit yourself one unto what? Another. So the summary of marriage principle is man, love and submit. Woman, submit and love. If you submit and love, your husband loves and submits, that's the perfect marriage.
Because whatever you submit to, you will want to please. You cannot hurt. You cannot harm. You want to make sure that the person is happy. When a challenge is coming, whether external or internal, you will join forces together to fight it. Because you both submit to yourselves and you both love yourselves. There will be peace. That's the summary of it. So please, it is not woman submit, man love. You cannot submit to what you don't love. So you too, you need to love. So don't say, I loved him, but I don't marry him. Somebody that even connected us, I just married him. I don't love him, but I'm submitting because scripture says we should submit. It's not possible. Submit and love. Don't marry who you don't love. Marry who you can love. It's important. Submit and love. And then the man loves and submit. There's peace. There's peace. Finally, the third reason why God created the woman. I'm rounding off. The third reason why God created a woman, God created the woman to express his image on the earth. To express God's image to your world. To express God's image to your world. Matthew chapter 5, verse 16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your moral excellence and your praiseworthy noble and good deeds, and recognize and honor and praise and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Romans chapter 18, verse 19, NIV. For the creation awaits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. To express God's image to your world. Your life is supposed to point your world to God. Your life is supposed to be a blessing to your world, beginning from your family, your children, because the charity begins at home. Before you affect your world, you should start from affecting your children. You should start from imparting your children. Let them see you and pray to marry a wife that is like you. If your son looks at you and does not desire to have your kind of person as a wife, it means you are failed. It means you're failed. So be that virtuous woman that when he sees you, he will admire you, and it will be his prayer point. Father, the wife I will marry should be like my mother. Start from your family. Affect your children positively. Let your life be a pointer to God. Be a model to your world. That when they see you, they want to serve your God. People want to serve your God because of the way you do your things, because of your lifestyle. You must be intentional about bringing up your children in the way of God. You must be intentional about it. Don't be passive. Don't be passive. Don't feel they are still tender. What will be, will be. They will grow. They will understand. See, what will be will not be. You must be intentional. Because the devil, your adversary, is not asleep. He's not asleep. So you must be intentional. You must deliberately cultivate God in them. The Bible says that children are like arrows in the hands of God. What do you do with arrows? You target them to their destination. They are arrows. God has targeted them to you and he has pointed them to you. He has directed them to you. It is your responsibility to direct them back to him. Some of you go to church, you leave your children behind. It's a risk. It's a big risk. It's a big risk. No matter your reason. Some of us, we don't want stress. So let them be at home. Stay at home, man. You want to be for them. Be watching cartoon. I'm going to church. You don't want stress. You don't want to carry them to church so that this one will not be running here, that one running there. It's better they are in church and running. Let them run. It's part of the thing that Jesus died for. Let them run inside church. There's a school called Catch Them Young. You don't want stress.
Or you feel, there's six more. Or there is even one that I heard recently. I've been looking for time to talk to that person, but no time. Maybe you are a church worker. You don't want to go late. And so you don't want them to make you go late. So you leave them at home just so that you will not go late. The reason is good, but it's a big risk. Let me tell you the two things that are involved. There are two things involved. Leaving your children behind, you are going to church. Devotion, you are sleeping, you are doing devotion, you are praying, they are sleeping. Whether they are sleeping, carry them. They should sit down there and be sleeping while you are praying. Whether they are sleeping, be praying there every morning. They should be there. Even if they are sleeping, let them be there. Because the atmosphere of the prayer is depositing something in them. Yeah, it's depositing something. Don't give any loophole to the devil. I always tell women, you are the number one enemy of the devil. It's in the Bible. You are the number, as a woman, you are the number one enemy of the devil. Your children are the number one enemy of the devil's children. It's not me that said it. It's God that puts the enmity there. It's God that puts it by himself. That's why you can't remove it. There's nothing you can do about it. It's God that puts it by himself. He spoke to the serpent. He said, put enmity between you and the woman. And between your seed and her seed. Somebody will say, Jesus has died, we are delivered. It is you that Jesus delivered. He didn't deliver the serpent. Because the curse was directed to the serpent. I put enmity between you and the woman. The one of other ones that God caused the woman, you have pain during delivery. It has been lifted by redemption. There are some women that give birth without pain. I've seen. It's called spiritual childbirth. I thank God for your life. There are a lot of women. There's one I know. Even my mother, she used to give birth at home. Self. My mother gave birth to two at home. It's only me that wanted to share cast money because, you know, I'm the only one that wanted to share cast money. You know, good things don't come easily like that. But that's very easy. Before you know, pia, baby is out. Two at home. There's so many women like that. Thank God we have. Supernatural childbirth. So God delivered you. Jesus delivered you. Delivered the man. But he didn't deliver serpent. So the curse is still there. So you must be vigilant. The worst mistake you can ever make as a woman is to think you can be spiritually asleep and all will be well. The devil is after you if you don't know. If you don't know, I'm telling you now so that you will know. So you must, your eyes should be red spiritually over your children. Over your children. Your eyes should be red, both spiritually and physically. Because the seed of the devil are the enemies to your children. And they are everywhere. They are in their schools. They are in your streets, in your compound, everywhere. They are there. So your eyes should, if you are a sleeping woman, the Bible says that women sleep, the enemy comes to sow tares. The seed you don't sow in the life of your children early, you don't sow the right seed early, the devil will sow the wrong one if you give the space. Talking about the risk of leaving your children behind, you are going to school. That's one of the risks. You don't sow the right seed early. The devil will sow the wrong seed. Because as you leave them behind, you go to church. You don't know the one they are seeing in that television. You don't know the thoughts that is entering their mind. Their destinies are exposed. Another reason why it is dangerous is that you are teaching them. Today you will bring them to church. Tomorrow you will not bring them to church. They are not consistent. You are teaching them that church service is not compulsory. And children learn early when they are at that stage. They learn early. You are teaching them that church service is not compulsory. Today you like, you go. Today you don't like, you stay at home. And once they learn it, when they grow, that's how they will live their life. They can wake up on Sunday and say, I'm not going today. Because they learned it when they were small. They learned it when they were small. There's a woman that I know, her children are grown now, but every Sunday she goes to church. She's so committed. So committed. A church worker dedicated. In fact, they are the ones that sit in front in their church. But her children don't go to church. They are grown now. Very grown. On Sundays, they are at home. Either they are watching movies or they are doing this. It is possible that this is how it started. Because there is no way you will, at that early stage, you build a passion for God in them. And they will grow. They will not stop. No, the Bible says, train up a child in the way it should go. And when he's old, he won't depart. He will not depart from it. There's no way you impact in them the consciousness of God. And they will grow and drop it. No. It doesn't come easily like that. So it's a risk. If they grow with that mindset, that church is not composed, the day they don't like, by the time they are grown, it will be a drag. You can't force them again to go to church. That's when you start seeing your child manifesting some character that you never ever believed that your child can will do. There's so many people you see, young boys, that are smoking, doing all sorts of things. Do you think that when their mother gave birth to them, she ever believed that the child would grow to become that kind of a person? No. But something went wrong somewhere. It is better you push them early to God. Occupy their head, their mind with God. Let them know that that's the right path. Talking about myself. Growing up as a child, I saw my mother so committed and dedicated to the things of God. You don't miss church for any reason in this world. Whether you are sick, she will tell you that that is where the healing is. Even school self, if you are sick, you go to school. How much more church? The only thing that will make you not go to school, maybe you are lying down, you are shaking, you can't get up. You know, almost being admitted. That's the, but that you are sick, so far you can walk. So far you can walk, you will go to school. How much more church? My mother was so committed in church. She hardly misses service. Whether it's one small service like this or one small meeting, she's there. Even if it is raining, she will carry umbrella. The rain started while we were at home. It's not as if rain met us on the road. We're seeing the house when the rain started. She will carry umbrella. Even if it's one umbrella, we are three, we will manage it. I remember one day like that, it was raining, one umbrella, me, my sister, and her, we're managing. One man saw us and he was laughing. He should come and laugh at me now. Because that thing is what brought me to where I am today. I grew with the mentality that you don't joke with the things of God. You don't miss service for any reason in this world. It is that important. Only God knows where the man is. But I can bet you, you can't compare where I am with wherever he is by the mercies of God. So I agree with that mentality. Heaven first, God first, church first. Everything is church. That's why all my life, everything is church. So the point that it affected my choice of job. I was very selective. Anyone that is that we affect evening service or choir rehearsal, I said, I won't take it. Point your children to God early. Another dangerous factor, leaving your children behind going to church. You don't push them. You don't drag them. You don't make them see how important it is for them to bury themselves in God. Is that you will miss the right timing to mold them and pattern them to the system of God or the will of God for their life. Because that's the stage where you mold. Where you mold children into being what God wants them to be. Once they pass that stage, you can't mold them. Their past is that they are past. Only thing you will do is advice. And at that time, it's their choice to take the advice or not to take it. But when they were small, that's when you should plant the seed. Mold them. They should see you committed to God. They should not see you take God casual. Praise the Lord. The Lord will give us grace in the name of Jesus. As you are impacting your children, impacting your family, impacting your husband, extend it to your world. Be a blessing to, there is one girl in that your street that is not getting things right. One day, call her, sit her down and say, I just have a lady to talk to you. Share the gospel with her. Preach to her. Invite her to church. Don't be afraid whether they will agree. Do it first. If he disagree, will you die? You have played your part. Play your part. Of course, it's not even you that is convincing before. It's the Holy Ghost. Just play your part and pray. Father, as I talk to this girl, convince her.
also, if you do it by influence, it's easier. Love her first. Be giving general counsel first. Maybe she has challenges, you call her advisor. Make her your friend. Once in a while, give her gifts, give her clothes, give her shoes, give her this. Influence. Then the day you talk to her about Christ, it will be easier. That's influence. It will be easier. It will be easier because she's secure with you. She's secure. You have been able to earn her respect, her value. Extend it to your world. Be a blessing to your society. Look at Dorcas. When she died, it was a society, women in the area that cried and said, no, this type cannot die. She's a blessing to us. They cried to Peter, and Peter prayed, and she came back to life. How many people will miss you when you are gone? In your society, leave family first. Your neighborhood. Let me not talk about death. It's far. But something carry you out of Ibuzo now. Maybe you travel. You relocate. Who will miss you in Ibuzo? What mark have you left? What mark? The Lord will give us grace in the name of Jesus Christ.